Thank you, Mr. Van Boze, for the very nice introduction. And I'm sure you're one of the people, that the person that is very happy with the, let's say, the renewed interest for materials. I have a long experience in the company, and 20 years ago or 15 years ago, materials were not very, what they call, sexy. They were a little bit old-fashioned, and people didn't realize indeed that they're so crucial. And so I'm very happy with this revival in the interest for advanced materials and their applications. What I plan to do is to give a short introduction on Umicore, to the company where I'm working for, and then give some perspectives, let's say some outcomes of the key enabling technology exercise in relation to what we are doing. So the first slide gives you a very global introduction to the Umicore Group. We are a materials technology company, global, that means that we are worldwide represented. And materials technology means for us materials based on metals, and specifically on precious metals, the platinum group materials, like platinum, palladium, iridium, rhodium, and the specialty materials, like germanium, cobalt, tellurium, and indium, and so on. The focus of our company is on clean technologies. That means for us, there are many definitions, but for us it means technologies designed to optimize the use of natural resources and reduce the environmental impact. And we are a Belgium-based company quoted on the Brussels Stock Exchange. Important for us is the business approach. And you see here a closed-loop model, and which is very critical for the company, and we'll also come back in the further part of my presentation. The focus on the science is on chemistry, material science, and metallurgy. And from metals, we produce added value products for applications, but we also close the loop and we take back intermediate products from the industry and also end-of-life products. So closing the loop is important for us, and it's always in our game. Our aim is always to develop processes that are environmentally friendly. With our products and our technologies, we are very much aligned with some of the key, let's say, megatrends and also societal challenges for Europe and for the rest of the world. One of them is the electrification of the automotive. It's one of the key, let's say, megatrends for us because we are a player, an important player in cathode materials for batteries. We have a long-standing experience in electronics, and we are now developing the right products for the automotive. We are focused with a closed-loop approach on resource scarcity, and we are the biggest recycler of precious metals, and we recycle out of very complex residues and intermediate products of end-of-life products. We recycle 20 different metals, as I said, specialty metals and precious metals. More stringent emission control is important. Let's say the electrification of the automotive will take some time. So in the meantime, there is still some work to be done on the emissions from cars and heavy-duty vehicles and so on. And there we play a role with catalysts for exhaust systems. And renewable energy, there we produce and we focus on materials for photovoltaics and fuel cells. The company, as I said, is worldwide represented, I have to say, and that's one of the challenges related to what we present today and what is the discussion of today. A lot of this industry is moving to Asia, and of course, as a company, we follow that to some extent. The R&D portfolio is 7% of the revenues of the company, and is focused around the five topics here on the screen: recycling, emission control, photovoltaics, fuel cells, and rechargeable batteries, which we call then, let's say, for us, the clean technologies of interest. Before I go more to the advanced materials downstream, I want to make the point here again on the importance, let's say, of the closed loop. If you take, for example, the energy materials or the energy technologies developed these days, many metals-based materials are playing a key role. And within these metal-based materials, there are metals, of course. And here you see a number of examples of that. In photovoltaics, you have germanium, gallium, selenium, tellurium, indium, and others, silver also. For the batteries, you have the lithium, cobalt, nickel, rare earth elements, and so on. For LEDs, you have gallium, indium, germanium, silver, so also many of these special metals, fuel cells, platinum, iridium, cobalt, and they are all present and they are crucial in the application, very difficult to replace, but they are not seen from the outside, so they are hidden, but they are extremely important. And if you then look at the critical materials as defined by the European Commission, which are quite similar to the critical materials defined by other geographical areas like in the US or Japan, you see many of these elements coming back. The critical materials are defined that materials that are very important from an economic point of view on the one on the horizontal axis and that have a risk of supply. And you see in the upper right quadrant a high risk of supply and importance for economy, you see many of these elements coming back, like cobalt, gallium, germanium, indium, and so on. So that means that indeed for the energy applications, for as an example, but there are other applications for energy, the metals, some of the metals and other products are extremely critical and important. And that's also why we always stress the point that you have these advanced materials developed on metals can only work if you add the closed loop and that you also take back the materials and use the minimum amount of materials for the application. And on top of that, you recycle or you reuse one way or another the materials that are not anymore used for the application. So that point that will also come back in other session, during the day after this one, where specifically we will have presentations on, this closed loop concept. Now coming back on the advanced materials and the strategy in Europe, as mentioned by Mr. Van Bozen, we have worked in the key enabling technology group, and key enabling technologies were defined as technology that will contribute to the growth and employment in Europe with innovative products. It will strengthen the value chains from the bottom. So not only buying materials outside and then assemble, but if you have the advanced materials in Europe, you can build an industry from the bottom. Creating other job opportunities in the downstream activities. And of course, they are proven to be important for societal challenges. As you see on this picture, you see that the materials are at the bottom. That's why they are hidden and very often neglected. They go into equipment, they go in components, and there the key enabling technologies were stressing the importance of materials. And then it goes into products that will meet the societal challenges. And you have many examples of them. In the report, we use these ones. It's the electrical vehicle, again, meeting the decarbonization of transport, where you see many of these key enabling technologies and advanced materials was one of them. Other ones were microelectronics, photovoltaics, and so on. And you see that all these key enabling technologies are very crucial in developing, an electrical vehicle. The same for the information digital society. You see here the smartphones, and also you probably know that in this kind of devices, you have all kinds of advanced materials present. And if you look at metals, for example, nearly all the metals of the table of Mendeleev are somewhere present in this kind of devices. Now, what is what are the issues or the difficulties in this industry? Is that first of all, in Europe we are facing, of course, a big competition, and the competition is mainly, in the first place, in recent years, coming from Asia. So the support there in Asia is fantastic. I mean, we are present in Korea, and the focus of their support is not only on research, but a lot on getting very quick new plants operational. So the permits are going very fast. You get immediately support from governments to be at the right place and get the right piece of land to start your operation, for example. So that means that the support is very strong, and not only financially, but also, I would say, with administration, with the support on permits, as mentioned. And so it's difficult to match this, this very proactive approach from the Asian countries to attract industry. The focus is also very much on fabrication, on production. As I said, not only on research, but also on production. And so they focus a lot on the science side, but they also focus a lot on implementing it and creating a full value chain. And you see here also on the graph some indicative numbers. Although we have always to be careful with interpretation, you see Europe, US, and the rest of the world, and you see that Europe is in general a little bit more, let's say, stronger on the side of, let's say, the upper parts, the funding. This is the case of nanomaterials, but you can have other examples in the same sense. In the patent, so the IP protection and these kind of things. But then if it comes really to production on the lower part, where it goes to supporting, let's say, the production of nano-based products, for example, there is much more tendency to support, let's say, also the pilot and the more, let's say, fabrication-oriented initiatives. And as also mentioned at the last bullet point again, we have not all the critical materials available in Europe, so we have to be careful there. Next point is that on the positive side, of course, we have considerable assets also in the advanced materials area. We have very good research, as mentioned before. We have good, fundamental science. We have also enough publications and these kind of things. But when it comes to, let's say, really translating that into manufacturing, it's a problem. And that's a problem that we know for a long time. And I give here the example of the batteries, but one of the next speakers will come back on that probably in more detail. It's that, for example, in the case of batteries, we see that in Europe we develop still a lot of patents and we are quite efficient in the fundamental research, but when it comes to really big scale industrial production, you see that 80-70% is done in Asia, and more specifically Japan, Korea, and recently also in China. So that doesn't mean that we have no competences in Europe. We have certainly the competences, but when it comes to really big manufacturing, it's moving in this case, and there are other cases, but this is a very good example, I think. It moved over time completely to Asia, and it's now a big challenge to get it back to Europe. And during the exercise of the key enabling technologies, the value of that came up. It's a very well-known, issue that we are facing, that everybody is facing, basically, is the issue of translating knowledge into business, into market access. Every country and every company has that problem, basically, but in Europe it seems to be more difficult to have that more efficiently done than in other areas. And that's what discussed, that was the focus of the key enabling technologies, to focus on the crossing of the valley of death. And there was the idea, let's say, came up, or the model came up, to support three pillars to make the bridge. The one on technological facilities, the second one on pilot lines and demonstrations, and also don't forget the competitive manufacturing as an important factor in the success for advanced materials and other technologies. In the case of advanced materials, there we say, okay, let's say if you want to bridge the value of that and make Europe more competitive in advanced materials, it has to be in the first place one of the priorities for the Horizon 2020. We have to work on the three pillars to bridge the value of debt. That means also that the RDI funding has to be rebalanced to more, let's say, the application side. We also recommend to have it more industry-driven, so that we have more, let's say, the market focus from the beginning. We also recommend to combine the funding mechanisms so that you create critical mass, because countries like China are putting big amount of money and efforts and human resources to catch up. So with small initiatives very much spread all over the place, we will not make it. So we say, okay, let's group industry money with European money and member states money. Special attention for IP policies and also for education and creating the, let's say, the basis of, let's say, the critical mass on human resources. And one of the initiatives that will be discussed this afternoon in a workshop is a proposal by 30 organizations in the advanced materials sector, of which 15 leading material companies of 10 countries in the EU, and they will propose to focus on the implementation of the SET plan, the energy plan. And in the SET plan, there is a materials roadmap, and they propose to focus with their group around, let's say, the materials part of it. And that will be done with an association with the name EMIRI, Energy Materials Industrial Research Initiative. And that will indeed try to regroup enough critical mass in Europe to make more effectively or efficiently use of the resources that exist and the money that is spent in this field. Of course, other organizations, universities, ERA network, and so on, will be part of the exercise. And as I said, the focus will be really on building the bridge from innovation, from creativity, let's say, invention, research towards markets. So to conclude, I have to say that advanced materials has been proven already many times, and this is agreed upon by many people in industry and also at EU, that is very important for the strategy of Umicore. Europe is facing global competition, that's clear. So we need to reinforce the efforts in that field, and more integration and strong attention to the bridging of the value of debt is important, and we have to be proactive. And that's why also this initiative, EMIRI, will take an initiative to try to convince to create a PPP. So this is my contribution on advanced materials. I thank you for your attention.